My name is Anthony DePue. I'm one of the co-founders of the Idaho Political Prisoner Foundation. I'm here with political prisoner Eric Parker's wife, Andrea Parker. And we have two updates we want to give you today. The first one is about Michael McGuire. He had a status hearing today. He has filed a motion to suppress all of his Facebook evidence because the government obtained a warrant, searched his Facebook, and rather than having a specific list of what they were to obtain, they just took it all. And from his Facebook alone, they've entered 13,000 entries, most of it, the overwhelming majority of which is personal in nature, and only 200 items out of the 13,600 is actually slated to be used in trial. He's saying that this is a violation of his Fourth Amendment right. It's tantamount to the police showing up at your house with a search warrant and just taking everything that you belong and saying, we'll give it back when we're done. That's not how it's supposed to work. Micah's hearing is key today because if he can put restrictions on the government to access your digital social media, other political prisoners are certainly going to follow suit. The issue that Mike is having is he can't simply say, you took 13,000 items, some of which were personal chats, completely unrelated to the case that's in front of them. He can't just say you took 13,000 items of evidence and filed it. He has to get a digital forensics expert to look at it and make sure that the government didn't misuse it. Well, guess what? The government had no problem getting a terabyte of information on these 19 defendants. They have the deep pocket of the taxpayer. Micah McGuire's attorney cannot get approval for $5,000 at least to hire this digital forensics expert to look at this and make sure that the government didn't open any of the stuff that they weren't supposed to. Now, the government, of course, maintains, we only looked at the 200 items that were related to the case. And don't worry, we only filed the 13 things for Micah's benefit in case he wants to be able to look at those items for his own defense. That's not how the Fourth Amendment works. That's not how our protection against warrantless searches and unreasonable search and seizure works. Micah is fighting this, and this is absolutely a case precedent-setting issue. And today we were in the courtroom. Normally, there's one U.S. attorney and a couple of marshals and supporters. Today there were other judges, there were other attorneys, because this could set precedent in the District of Nevada.
There was an FBI agent, special agent in charge. I was really surprised because I've been to quite a few of these hearings, and usually that side's almost completely empty. And today they had an entire side filled up that we actually ended up having to make them squeeze into one seat so that we could, our supporters could sit on that side.
It's an unprecedented amount of show from the government today for what would normally be a very routine hearing. No matter what happens here in the District of Nevada, this is why this is important, is because it's going to end up in the Ninth Circuit. No matter what decision, whether the decision goes Micah's way, the government's going to appeal this in the Ninth Circuit, and if this court doesn't go the way that Micah wants him to go for his Fourth Amendment violation, he's going to take it to the Ninth Circuit. This is a big deal. The foundation is going to continue to watch this. We're going to continue to support Michael McGuire. He's a political prisoner. Alicia McGuire is here today. She drove from Arizona. She's in meeting with the attorney because they're both in the same place at the same time, so she wasn't able to be with us. That's the update for Micah McGuire. We're going to continue to follow this. He has a status hearing update scheduled for late July after the next Tier 3 hearing begins. We'll be there to watch and see what the outcome of that is. Andrea has an update about Todd Engel and his sentencing guidelines and the recommendation from the government.
First, let's throw the date out for Micah's hearing. It is July 28th at 9:30 in the morning.
That's a Friday.
Okay, so Todd Engel got his government's suggestion for his sentencing. Now, Todd Engel was found guilty of only two counts. The first one was obstruction of justice and interstate travel and aid of extortion.
Yep.
Only two of the charges. He got his sentencing guidelines, is that what they call them, or the government?
The government's recommendations
point system.
For Todd's sentencing.
And point system. Eric told me they've seen other guys' papers in the jail, and they're usually a couple pages long. His is 20 pages long. And in there, there's a lot of information, how they come to their points system. Now, they found 37 points for Engel. And there's a few things in there that, you know, Eric was explaining to me on the phone. And one of them, first, that really rang true to me, and I've been saying this for a while, he got +5 points for terrorism. So here I've been saying that they're using the Patriot Act and they're doing this, and obviously it's true. If they can, +5 points for acts of terrorism. They gave him plus a couple points for brandishing a weapon, even though he was not found guilty of brandishing a weapon. The wording, the way they word this, they were wording it like, well, all of the other charges were undecided. So some people still did think that he was guilty. And they're using all of that against him. This does need to be appealed and fought because they're suggesting 220 months. It's over 18 years.
Just over 18 years.
And he was only found guilty of two of the charges. That pretty much sets a precedent that no matter what charge they get on you, they are going to throw everything they possibly can at you. They are using the Patriot Act. I think that needs to be huge. Right? You know, everyone wants to write letters. Let's write letters and demand that they change the Patriot Act. They cancel it, get rid of the Patriot Act. Because it is being used on American citizens, and this is proof right here. You can't be found guilty of two charges and serve more than people who are pleading out for a whole bunch of charges. And, like, how much more time is Greg going to get if the point system is a 40-point system and Engel for two charges got 37 points? This is crazy. There was a picture in the 20 pages, and the picture's of Legos. And they say, you know, oh, the victims are these agents and the BLM agents and the FBI agents. And he gets plus points because he's affected their family members. One of their family members. Who is to know for sure that that was made by a child? First off, how is the child even knowing about the wash can be able to depict the wash in Legos if they're not being coached to do so? And he's getting plus points for affecting the victims' families. This is an outrage, and we need to start making noise about it.
The issue here is this is not reasonable justice. There is no way that this is a reasonable measure of justice. Even if you were to adopt the government's narrative for what they say happened, Todd Engel is a man, and this was all in footage. This all came out in the trial. He came to protest. He showed up that morning. He was standing in the parking lot, and a woman ran over and said, "They're down in the wash, and they're going to start shooting people." That's why everyone went over to the edge of that bridge to see what was going on. Todd Engel saw federal agents with weapons pointed at him. He crouched down for a second. He stood up. He took a picture. And when they said to disperse over the bullhorn, he ran to the Nevada State Troopers, to the Nevada Highway Patrol, and he stood there on dash cam for 90 minutes. When he was done, he shook their hands. They patted each other on the back, and they went their separate ways. Convicted of two counts, the government wants to put this man away for 18 years. And here's what's really offensive about this. The reason our men are sitting in prison for over a year without a trial is because the government knows that if they charge you with a Section 924C, use or carry of a firearm in relation to a crime of violence, if they charge you with that, the Bail Reform Act says that you can't go home. Here's the problem. Last week, 23 members of a motorcycle club were indicted in Nevada. They were down in Pahrump with our guys. They stood before a judge in this very courthouse. They are all charged with racketeering, murder, kidnapping, vehicle theft, and two counts of 924C. They all went home 2 days after they came in. They got a detention hearing, and they all went home. So if you're a part of a motorcycle gang, you have the right to the presumption of innocence, and you can get pretrial release, and you can come back and go to court. But if you happen to be in a place where people are protesting against the federal government, and
where
the government,
no violence happened.
There's no violence, there's no victim. The only victims are the people that stood there on that bridge and were assaulted by the federal government when they pointed fully automatic machine guns. And Agent Swanson testified that he had the safety off, ready to kill Eric Parker, and he didn't do it. The people on the bridge were assaulted. The wrong 19 people are indicted. And we can see it right here in Nevada. If you're a part of a motorcycle gang accused of racketeering, you have the right to the presumption of innocence. If you came and you protested against the government, you do not. You will sit in prison indefinitely until they decide to get around to try you. And if they can't get a conviction, they'll come back and they'll do it again with different evidence. This is what we're seeing in the District of Nevada. This is what's happening to Michael McGuire. It's happening to Todd Engel. It's happening in Oregon. It's happening to the rest of these guys. And so that's why we're out here today. The foundation is here. We're here with one of the spouses. Another is in visiting with an attorney. This is why we need your donations, because we're going to take care of these guys. We're going to make sure that they have access to legal resources, to telecommunications, to basic necessities. That's what we're here to help them provide. They are not getting a reasonable amount of justice. They are not getting due process, and we're here to document it and tell everybody about it.